This video is brought to you by MyWayTeaching.com.
So in this particular form or in this particular part, we are going to study about the various forms of energy, the law of conservation of energy. Okay. So we have already seen that mechanical energy can be divided into two distinct categories. One is based on its motion, that is kinetic energy, and the other one is based on its configuration, that is known as potential energy. So energy comes in many forms which transform into one another in ways which may not often be clear to us. So we have various forms of energy. So let us consider few of those. So the first form is heat. It is one of the important form of energy. Okay. We have seen that the frictional force is not a conservative force. However, work is associated with the force of friction. So in the example of a block of mass M sliding on a rough horizontal surface with the speed V naught, it comes to a halt after a distance x naught, isn't it? So the work done by the force of kinetic friction F over x naught is given by minus F into x naught. So by the work energy theorem, we can write it as M V naught square by 2 is equal to F x naught, isn't it? So if we confine our scope to mechanics, we would say that the kinetic energy of the block is lost due to the frictional force. So on examination of the block and the table, we would detect a slight increase in the temperatures. So the work done by the friction is not lost, but it is transferred as heat energy. Okay. So this raises the internal energy of the block and the table. So in winter, in order to feel warm, we generate heat vigorously by rubbing our palms together, isn't it? So there also mechanical energy is converted into heat energy. So a quantitative idea of transfer of heat energy is obtained by noting that 1 kg of water releases about 42,000 joules of energy when it cools by 10 degrees Celsius. Okay. So 1 kg of water releases about 42,000 joules of energy when it cools by 10 degrees Celsius. Okay. So this is about the heat energy. So now moving to the next form, that is chemical energy. See, one of the greatest technical achievements of humankind occurred when we discovered how to ignite and control fire, isn't it? So we learned to rub two flint stones together, that is mechanical energy, and got them to heat up and to ignite a heap of dry leaves, that is chemical energy, which then provided sustained warmth. So a matchstick ignites into a bright flame when struck against a specially preferred chemical surface. So the ignited matchstick, when applied to a firecracker, it results in a spectacular display of sound as well as light, isn't it? So this chemical energy arises from the fact that the molecules participating in the chemical reaction have different binding energies. A stable chemical compound has less energy than a separated parts. So a chemical reaction is basically a rearrangement of atoms. Okay, so if the total energy of the reactants is more than the products of the reaction, the heat is released and the reaction is called as exothermic. So if the reverse is true, heat is absorbed, then it is called as endothermic. So if heat is released, then it is called as exothermic reaction. If the heat is absorbed, then it is called as endothermic reaction. See, for example, coal, it consists of carbon and a kilogram of it when burnt releases about 3 into 10 raised to 7 joules of energy. Coal, it consists of carbon when it is burnt, it releases about 3 into 10 raised to 7 joules of energy. Okay, so chemical energy is associated with the forces that give rise to the stability of substances. So these forces bind atoms into molecules, molecules into polymorphic chains. The chemical energy arising from the combustion of coal, cooking gas, wood and petroleum, all those things are really indispensable to our daily existence. Okay. So now, the another form of energy, that is electrical energy. See, the flow of electric current causes bulbs to glow, fans to rotate and bells to ring. So there are laws governing the attraction and repulsion of charges and currents. So we'll study about all those things in the coming chapters. So energy is associated with an electric current. An urban Indian household consumes about 200 joules. Okay, of energy per second on an average. So the equivalence of mass and energy. See, till the end of 19th century, physicists believed that in every physical and chemical process, the mass of an isolated system is conserved. Matter might change its phase. For example, glacial ice could melt into a gushing steam, but matter is neither created nor destroyed. Albert Einstein, he showed that mass and energy are equivalent and they are related by his famous equation, that is E is equal to mc square, where c is the speed of light in vacuum. And that is equal to 3 into 10 raised to 8 meter per second. Isn't it? Thus, a amount of energy is associated with the mere kilogram of matter. That is E is equal to 1 into 3 into 10 raised to 8 whole square, which is equal to 9 into 10 raised to 16 joules energy associated with a kilogram of matter. So that is equivalent to an annual electrical output of a large power generating station. Okay. So another form of energy, that is nuclear energy. The most destructive weapons made by man, the fission and fusion bombs, are manifestations of the above equivalence of mass and energy, that is E is equal to mc square. So on the other hand, the explanation of the how life nourishing energy output of the sun is also based on the nuclear reactions. So in this case, effectively, four light hydrogen nuclei fuse to form a helium nucleus whose mass is less than the sum of the masses of the reactants. So this mass difference, that is called as mass defect, is the source of energy, that is delta m into c square. Four hydrogen will combine to form a helium whose mass is less than the masses of the reactants, that is called as mass defect. In fission, a heavy nucleus like uranium-235 is split up by a neutron into lighter nuclei. Once again, the final mass is less than the initial mass, and the mass difference translates into energy, so which can be tapped to provide electrical energy, as in nuclear power plants which are controlled by nuclear fission, or it can be employed in making nuclear weapons. Okay, strictly the energy, that is delta E, released in a chemical reaction can also be related to the mass defect. Okay, the energy which is released, it can be related to the mass defect, that is given by delta M is equal to delta E by C square. Okay. So, however, for a chemical reaction, this mass defect is much smaller than for a nuclear reaction. So, you can see in the table, the approximate energy which is associated with various phenomena, approximate amount of energy that is released when various reactions takes place, like Big Bang, radio energy emitted by the galaxy during its lifetime, rotational energy of the Milky Way, all those things.